Thank you for joining me for creating a research log. My name is AP Anderson. I'm a research and instruction librarian at Velma K. Waters Library at Texas A&M University Commerce. And the topic of today's workshop, we're going to be talking about one of the many ways that you can keep track of all of the different resources that you utilize or consult during the research process. So starting out, what is a research log? Really, I know that this feels like a cheap answer, but it's whatever you need it to be. The purpose of a research log is just to keep you on track, make sure that you don't lose things that you've consulted, and it also provides a place for you to keep notes. It can be a very simple object that you use to keep yourself organized, or you can make it as complex as it needs to be. There are a lot of things that keeping track of your research like this can help you with. For instance, if you notice that you are finding a lot of similar types of angles being talked about on a specific topic, that might be easier to spot if you have just a document listing out everything that you found, rather than trying to look at all of the different search engines and databases and just try to guess. It's okay. Also a good way of determining, okay, is there an actual gap in the research that I'm seeing? Or is it a situation where maybe there are some terms I haven't considered, some resources I haven't consulted, and try to figure out if it's a problem in the literature that's keeping you from figuring out what you need, or if there's a way that you can tweak your strategy. And also, we've all had those research projects where the scope of it tends to get a lot larger than we were planning. We possibly veer off into the weeds and find a fun new topic that doesn't necessarily fit what we're doing. That doesn't have to be wasted effort. Even if you can't use what you find in your current project, if you take note of that, you can use it in future research. But I would argue that probably the most important reason to track your research progress as you go is to save yourself time. That can be simple in terms of, okay, yesterday I was looking at psych info and I think I got as far as I could. I'm going to be going into JSTOR now this week and trying it that way, and not having to backtrack to figure out what you did the last time you looked at stuff, especially on very long projects where you're working on this over time, such as a thesis or a dissertation. The other thing that's really useful about it is that if you end up in a situation where you have to go and change your research question around, it can be very valuable to go back to the very beginning of your research process and figure out what you were doing at the start and use that to recalibrate rather than trying to just figure out where you are then. And also, it's really good for helping you from having to do things in duplicate more than you need to. It's never necessarily a bad thing to run a search more than once, but if you're running it with literally the same variables, you're going to get literally the same answers. And that will help you spot, am I using literally the same variables or did something change? Up next, I do want to clarify, there is a difference between a research log and a reference manager. So a reference manager, also sometimes called a citation manager, is typically going to be like a third-party tool. This is your RefWorks, this is EasyBib, this is something that you're using as like either a browser-based website that you make an account on, or it is a downloadable software that is designed to organize the resources that you consult. It's going to be different than a research log. Research log is something that you create. It is designed to meet your needs as a researcher and keep track of your notes and your progress. It's a really good idea to use both of them, in my opinion. Or if you don't want to use a reference manager, get yourself a Google Sheet or a Google Doc and keep track of your citations that way. It can be risky to keep all of your hard work on especially a very long project like a thesis or a dissertation, something that you're creating for publication, in one document. And it's a really dangerous maneuver to keep that one document only saved in one place. Just as a word of advice learned from my pain, please back up your documents. Back them up in multiple places. I've heard good advice is to save three copies of anything that you would be devastated to lose, and make sure one of those copies is not connected to the internet. So on a thumb drive or an external hard drive or something, just in case, because things happen. You could drop your laptop in Garvin Lake, and then your dissertation's gone. Google could go out of business tomorrow, and you lose your Google Docs. Things happen in terms of technology that we can't always predict. So always back up your documents. That's my soapbox today. Most databases that you're going to encounter for pulling academic resources have a little button somewhere around typically the top or one of the sidebars of any page where you're looking at a full text of an article that has a little cite button. And you can usually click that, and that's where they hide the option to export your citation to a reference manager. You can also use it to just create a ready-made citation in the style manual of your choice, but please always double-check that for accuracy. No automatic citation generator is going to be 100% accurate, and I've noticed that a lot of them, even ones that are pretty good, tend to have a difficult time differentiating between authors' first and last names, especially with multiple authors, and then volume and issue numbers for journals, and they just get them confused. So always look with your human being eyes, and don't just trust the software to do it. The same is true in reference managers. Many of them have the option to create a bibliography from the sources that you export into it, but always double check. There are different databases that have different reference manager tools that they play nicely with. You'll have to just kind of play around and see what they have. But most of them will give you the option to download it either as like an XLS document, which is a Microsoft Excel spreadsheet document, or as plain text that you can open in Notepad. But again, you don't have to use a reference manager. You can just copy your citations and put them somewhere else and consult them later, just as long as you label them. That is going to be different than the process of note taking. We do have access to RefWorks through TAMU-C. Students have access to the full version. You can log in using your credentials. However, the tricky thing is that after you graduate, you no longer have access to that. So you will need to export it before you leave TAMU-C. EndNoteWeb and Zotero are two that a lot of our students use. They are able to keep those outside of being a TAMU-C student. However, they are both like freemium options. So they have subscription plans with more storage and better features, but are free-ish. We can talk about those later, but I just wanted to show you real quick. This is how you get into RefWorks. If you go to the library homepage, we have our lovely search tool with all its little tabs. The databases tab is your friend. You'll just search RefWorks, go in, click into it, pick A&M Commerce from the dropdown, and then log in with your credentials. So that will be a way of keeping all of your citations that you encounter. Now we're going to talk about what kind of notes that you'll take, the supplementary materials that you'll add to your research log as you go, to make the research process more meaningful and mindful and keep you from having to backtrack as much. As I said earlier in the video, there is no one specific format for what a research log has to be. Caveat, unless you are doing a research log for your class, in which case, always do exactly what your instructor tells you. But if you're doing this for yourself or as a supplement to a project that you're doing in class, it can really be whatever you need it to be. The most important thing is that you're tracking information that is useful to you. So there are a few ways that you can do that. One, I always recommend keeping track of your search strategy. So as you search certain keywords and certain databases and certain discovery tools like, Google Scholar or a library database catalog search, write down where you are searching and what keywords you are using in which combinations and which filters that you are applying. This is going to be important because it's very possible that you will enter into a situation where you've accidentally cut yourself off from a whole section of resources that you could use. And the research log will help you see, oh, I was going to search this, I just left it out. Or, man, that filter that I applied really took out like two-thirds of the responses that I was hoping to get. Let me go get rid of that. You can also take note of the different types of resources that you're finding every time you try a new search string. And I also always recommend that people keep just an interesting sources document somewhere, whether that is in a resource resource manager or the bottom of a Google Doc, or you email it to yourself. If you find something that sparks your interest, whether it is going to be useful for your current project or not, I always recommend grabbing the permalink for that and then like the title and keeping that somewhere, because you never know when a future research project might just need that thing. I have been told that this is kind of digital hoarding, but it's okay. I've accepted this about myself. So another good feature of using a research log is that you can use it to keep track of your keywords and help you generate more. So this is an example of a way that you can take a research question and break it down into keywords. And so we have, what is the effect of social media on teenagers' mental health? And we've broken it down into three major concepts: social media, teenagers, mental health. And then from there, we can go in and expand on those and find related terms, synonyms, things that you might be able to swap in or out. You don't have to search for all of these, but if you're running into situations where you're not finding what you need, it might be worth it to try things that are a little bit more specific or a little bit to the left and the right of what you were originally trying. And if you notice that there are a lot of terms that are coming up that aren't related to what you need, you can set down and say, I want to exclude wellness apps and therapy apps. Because when I was doing the search just to see what was there, that was one of the things that was coming up, is do these therapy apps actually work? And I'm like, well, that is a valid research question, but it's not what I need. So I want to just take note, this is something that does not apply to me. And then as you do your research, you can take this document and expand on it as you find new terms that are relevant. I found, you know, screen time and the 13 to 17 year old age range and well-being. And I just toss those into my thing to find for future searches. There are some terms that I added initially, but then realized weren't really doing what I thought they would. So instead of deleting them, I just marked them out to let me know, don't search them, but be aware you might have to come back to them later. And so this is just a place. This is going to be the ever-growing document. You don't have to delete anything. It's where all of these terms go to live in eternity. You will record your searches somewhere else if you're using this model of a research log. And then that is when the search tracking comes. So search tracking is important because it helps you keep kind of a bird's eye view of your research process. It lets you see what you've done, what you still have to do, and sort of the trends that you're encountering as you go into each leg of the research process. You can see what changes when you swap your variables in and out, and when you try a more specific database versus a general catalog search, and try to figure out like what aspects of the resources you're using do you actually like? What's more valuable to you? Is it better for you to use a narrower database that doesn't have as many resources in it, that has really good filters that are very specific for what you need? As an example, we'll see it on the next page. The database PsycInfo has filters that allow you to limit by population, such as age range. So you don't have to use teenagers as a keyword. You can just say the 13 to 17 age range and you're good. However, they don't have as many different types of articles as something like Google Scholar or a full library catalog search. So you have to decide what's most useful to you. And that overview helps you keep that in mind. One of the other things that is useful about writing down your search strategy is that you can take that document to somebody else and say, is there something I am missing? If you take this to your instructor, who is an expert in their field, they might be able to tell you the terms that you are using aren't what is most current in our field. You should try X, Y, and Z. Nobody calls it this anymore. That's why you're only getting old articles. Try this. Or conversely, I know that you're using the most recent terminology for this, but this is an issue that we've studied for a really long time. And back in the 1980s, we called it this. So if you're wanting to find those older resources, you're not going to be able to find them if you're using 2024 language. So that's a really good usage of this document to help you get better help from the people that are in the corner. Similarly, you can take it to a librarian. And you can say, this is everything that I've tried. What am I missing? Is there some strategy? Am I not applying filters correctly? Have I accidentally excluded a bunch of results because of how I've structured my search? Are there resources that I haven't considered exploring yet? And so that is a really good way of making sure that when you go do get help, one, you don't have to sit there and verbally explain every step of your research process, but also this second set of eyes, this other person, is going to be able to look at this from an overview with you and help you spot ways to improve your search strategy and get better results. Here's two kind of opposite ends of the spectrum for levels of detail that you can have for tracking your searches. On your left, you have something super simple. If you wanted to like email this to yourself and just kind of have like a back and forth email chain with yourself, that is like an appropriate amount of information. You can just say like, on this day, I checked this database. These are the things that I searched. These are the filters I used. I put 12 articles into RefWorks. 390 came up. Here's what I'm going to do next week when I sit down to research again. But possibly that is not enough information for you. So you can take on the right side of the screen, you can actually go in and add just written out notes about what you found. I'm getting a lot of stuff about COVID. I don't really need to know this. I don't really want to know about using social media as a tool to track mental health of large populations at once. I'm really wanting to know what is the effect of mental health on individuals, not groups? So I'm going to have to figure out how to get rid of these other results that I'm seeing or get more specific and tailored to what I actually need. And so it's just really what you need. I tend to make these in Google Docs just because two factors. One, it's good for me to share with other people if I need to. And two, I don't need to get super complicated with it. So I can just make a table and fill it out as I go. However, if you have a huge project, like if you're doing a systematic review and you need to break down hundreds of articles that you're looking at, it might be a good idea to do something like this in a table format, like Excel or Google Sheets, so that you can sort it as you need and just do multiple pages like that. I have actually made a template that I can send the link to y'all for. And for those of you in the future who are watching this as a recording, I'm going to put it in the description of the YouTube video as well. This is one that I made. Please feel free to either make a copy of it if you're logged into Google or download it so that you can use it if you don't have a Google account that you're logged in as. Please don't request edit access. This is just a template, but it's a three-page thing. It has a page for how to generate keywords, a page for tracking your sources, and a place that you can go put interesting resources, whether you want to use them for this project or not. And I've gone and I've filled in the first row on everything just to show how it works. But this is something that I've listed as Creative Commons, and it can be remixed as much as anybody likes. So if you don't like the search tracker, get rid of it. If you want to add additional columns to track additional things, this is yours to do it as you wish. It's just a resource for you. It is something that I hope will be useful if, as nothing else, is just like an example of what this kind of document can be. But as I've said, the point of keeping a research log is going to be pretty personal. It's going to be you as a researcher figuring out trends in the sources that you're finding and keeping kind of a close eye on your own progress and making sure that there's not something major that you're missing. So it needs to be whatever will serve your purposes. So with that, here are the lovely faces of our research and instruction team at Velma K. Waters Library. If you ever need help, either with, figuring out what to include in your research log or any part of the research process, please reach out to us. That email address at the top is a shared email inbox, and it goes to all four of us at once. And we can meet with you individually, or if you're an instructor, we can go meet with your class. And this is what we love to do. We love to help students and researchers with this process so that they can become more confident and make sure that they are answering the questions that they need answers to, whether that's for class, for personal projects, for publication, the betterment of the world. Man, I'm just getting on a soapbox here. Thank you so much. I really appreciate y'all attending.